Last weekend in Chicago was like a coming out party for one Sammy Sosa. Sosa had been 0 for 18 at the plate until the bottom of the ninth when Paul Wilson hung this slider that Sosa promptly deposited it onto Waveland Avenue, spoiling Wilson's bid for a complete game. On Sunday, Harnish was victimized in the first. Sosa went deep to left field, but the big blow came in the ninth inning. Again, Sosa hitting this one across the street and left to win the game for the Cubs, pinning the loss on the Mets and on Jerry DePoto. The New York Mets seek revenge against Sammy Sosa and the Cubs next on 9. From Shea Stadium in beautiful Flushing by the Bay, New York. Tonight, the New York Mets host the Chicago Cubs. Mets Baseball 96 is brought to you by Miller Lite. When you've got the great taste of Miller Lite, life is good. By your Tri-State Ford dealer. By Shell, the best-selling gasoline in the world. And by Coca-Cola. Always playing, always Coca-Cola. The starting pitchers in tonight's game for the Chicago Cubs, right-hander Frank Castillo, 1-3 on the year, and for the Mets, right-hander Bobby Jones, 2-1.
Hello once again, everybody, and welcome to another evening of Mets Baseball. I'm Tim McCarver, along with Gary Thorne. The Mets and the Cubs, the first of three, and Woody Allen, Gary, said that 80% of success is showing up. It certainly hasn't been the case for the Mets the last week. They have lost some very, very tough ball games.
He wasn't talking about baseball, apparently, no. When he was talking about showing up. For the New York Mets on the road trip, it has been a tough one. 1-5, they lost to the Cubs last Friday and Sunday. On both occasions, ninth inning home runs by Sammy Sosa, who going into that series was in a real drought, an 0-for-18 at the plate, in fact. Then they went to Florida, led only once in three losses in Florida, allowed 4 7-inning runs on Wednesday, a 6-3 defeat. Rico Bronya said tonight coming back, he says, I don't think we ever got over the losses in Chicago when we got to Florida. We were devastated by Sammy Sosa's two home runs that knocked us out. He says, it's time. We need to win here at home. We got to get one in the W column.
Looking for a different weekend against the Cubs this weekend, and we'll see how they do right after this from Bell Atlantic. Absolutely gorgeous spring evening as Nelson Doubleday authoritatively pointing his left finger to Dallas Green. No, folks, the Mets are 13-19, but no, it's not quite that time yet.
Nelson's not talking about anything related to that.
That's right.
Dallas Green's probably thinking about that, but Nelson's not talking about it.
Well, you know, when a manager is on a one-year contract and he gets off to the start that the Mets are off to, fairly or unfairly, those things are talked about. But the Mets hoping to turn this weekend around after that disaster last weekend. Jim Riggleman, on the other hand, the Chicago Cubs, Ed Lynch, Andy McPhail, very confident that this young man can do the job, and nothing talked about in Chicago that Riggleman is anything but in place as the manager of the Cubs, perhaps for another 2 or 3 years.
Eddie Lynch certainly hopes so. He's very happy with him and likes working with him and the way he conducts his business.
Bobby Jones has won 2 straight starts, and he will be up against Frank Castillo. So Bobby Jones, 2-1 on the year, and 4-1 lifetime against Chicago.
Let's take a look at the lineup here for the Chicago Cubs. Brian McRae in center field will be leading it off. Ryan Sandberg at second base batting second. Mark Grace at first. He's over the flu now. Sammy Sosa, the nemesis of the Mets in right field cleanup. Gonzalez in left field will be batting fifth. Scott Servais doing the catching will bat sixth. Gomez is at third base tonight. He'll be batting seventh. Sanchez, the shortstop, goes eighth and pitching for them at batting ninth. Frank Castillo, the Cubs lineup brought to you by Honda.
Center fielder Brian McRae.
And we'll take a look at the defense for the Mets. Bernard Gilkey in left. Lance Johnson in center, and yes, Butch Huskey is back in right. Jeff Kent, the third baseman. Ray Ordonez at shortstop. Jose Vizcaino at second. Rico Bronya in there at first, and Todd Hundley behind the plate. And the first pitch of the ball game to Brian McCray is in there for a strike. Nothing and one to the Cubs leadoff hitter, and he is a keeper on his last year of his contract. And he fouls one off. This guy is a terrific leadoff player. He has stolen 15 of 16 bases this year. His high in stolen bases, 28. He did that back in 1994.
Kind of hard to believe, Timmy, that he wondered whether he could be a leadoff hitter coming into the spring training this year. Knew he was going to be asked to play that role probably, but and last year, but wasn't sure whether or not that really was where he belonged. I don't think there's much question anymore.
One ball, two strikes to Brian McCray. Just underway here at Shea, and the fastball just misses 2-2. I think Brian getting out from under the yoke of playing for his father, Hal, in Kansas City. One of the best career moves for him as he chops one towards short. Ordonez throws him out. One away.
Probably a little easier for him to do things he thinks he should do for himself.
Batting second,
rather than worry about, and I don't mean negatively, but wanting, he loves his father and wants to do
certainly
what dad thinks is the right thing for him. But here he can worry a little less about that, more about what he's doing for himself.
Take another father-son situation with Felipe Alou, his son Moises flourishing under his tutelage for the Montreal Expos. Ryan Sandberg, the batter, and he takes a strike. So Greg Pavlik telling Gary Thorne before the game that he and Dallas have been preaching first pitch strike. Bobby Jones has done it to the first two hitters. Kerr fouled off, nothing and two to Sandberg.
And kind of surprising what Pav said, that the pitchers were reluctant to throw their pitches. And what he was meant by that was the best pitch that each of them has, they've been reluctant to go ahead and challenge the hitters with it. And that, I guess, Timmy, would be the confidence factor he was mentioning. When you're not confident, then you're trying to do something else other than go to your strength.
Still 0-2 to Sandberg. There are so many ways to talk about what staying ahead does for pitchers and what it does to hitters. A lot of ways of explaining also how you do that. But when you can make a hitter reach like Sandberg, you record the second out of the inning.
Good work by Bobby Jones right there. He set that pitch up on Sandberg, who is struggling at the plate a bit, but he busted him inside with one of those pitches after he got the strike. Then down and away with what looked like a pretty good breaking ball. Had good movement on it and made him reach and got it off the end of the bat.
See, if you don't stay ahead, hitters aren't going to reach. If the count's two balls and a strike, they don't reach for a pitch like Sandberg had to do with nothing and two. Foul the first one off. And the good curveball got him. Ball one to Grace. 1-0 to Mark Grace, batting 354 on the young season. Doing nothing. Well, there'll be another number 23 in New York tomorrow afternoon as the Knicks and the Bulls go at it. Game three of the NBA playoffs. Fly ball left field. Bernard Gilkey over. And an easy inning for Bobby Jones as the Cubs go in order. We're back after this from WCBS-FM. First inning, Tim McCarver and Gary Thorne here at Shea on a lovely evening. Frank Castillo was the loser to Bobby Jones last Saturday at Wrigley Field. And Frank Castillo, 27 years old, and you see that ignominious stat on there. Only 10 walks, and yet he's from El Paso, Texas.
Ooh la la. Our Mets lineup is brought to you by your Tri-State Quality Ford dealer. For the Mets, Lance Johnson leading it off, swinging a hot bat right now in center field. Jose Vizcaino, second base, the same there. Bernard Gilkey, good top three for the Mets. Todd Hundley in the cleanup spot again. He's been moved up. Rico Bronya at first base, batting fifth. Jeff Kent, third base, sixth. Butch Huskey in right field, batting seventh. Number eight hitter, Ray Ordonez, the shortstop, and doing the pitching and batting ninth, Bobby Jones.
Lance Johnson takes a curve from Frank Castillo for a strike. Lance, a terrific road trip, batting 407, but a trip in which the Mets went 1-5. They have lost four in a row. The Cubs, on the other hand, since that Sosa home run last Sunday, they lost three in a row to Montreal.
Both those Expos. The surprise of baseball right now.
Lined foul, 1-1. The Expos with the best record in baseball as we speak. Montreal 23-12, a game and a half in front of the Atlanta Braves in the National League East.
As long as they have $5 tickets and $1 hot dogs, they can draw 40,000 people.
Jammed with the slider is Johnson. Castillo covering. One out here in the first. Jose Vizcaíno coming up.
Second,
yeah, after that evening where they had the $5 tickets, they had 13,000 people.
Look at this. The most improved teams in the National League from 95 to this year. The Montreal Expos are right there on top. You see the win percentage, what they've moved from, followed by San Diego and the Pittsburgh Pirates. Teams that are having to do it on the short dollar are getting it done at the start of this year.
Jose Vizcaíno now. He lifts one to center field, and McCray over, an easy play for Brian. Two quick outs here in the first. Well, maybe Woody Allen was talking about teams doing it on the short dollar. 80% of it is showing up. Maybe the Expos, Padres, and Pirates are doing it at 80 cents on the dollar. As we take a look at the defense for the Cubs, Gonzalez, McCray, Sosa, great arms in the outfield. Gomez, Sanchez, Sandberg, Grace, and Service behind the plate, and a strike to Gilkey. Bernard, a good road trip also. Tapped foul, nothing and two to Gilkey. As a matter of fact, on that road trip, the first four batters in the Mets lineup, Johnson, Vizcaíno, Gilkey, and Hundley combined to bat 387. 387. And that gives you an idea of what little production the bottom of the order had from 5 through 8.
That means your table setters are getting on, and Johnson and Vizcaíno, and now with Gilkey in the third hole and Hundley moved up into that cleanup spot. Big difference. Big difference. Good numbers both ways for Gilkey, home and road.
Still a ball and two strikes to Bernard Gilkey. Just underway here at Shea, and Todd Hundley on deck. Curveball misses, 2-2 to Bernard Gilkey. Slider misses, full count to Bernard.
Frank Castillo is one of the better changeups in baseball. Not an overpowering pitcher, a good fastball, but the changeup, when it's on, he can throw it for strikes. We'll use it anywhere in the count.
Fastball there, rifle to right field. Sosa back on the track to make the play. The Mets go in order. No base runners, no score after one. We'll be back after this from your Tri-State Ford dealer. Out on hand. Friday evening, the Cubs in town. I'd say it looks like somewhere between 15,000 and 18,000. Sammy Sosa leads it off to a chorus of boos, and that's because of what he did to the Mets last weekend.
Sweet music to his ears.
You bet. Strike on the outside corner. Three home runs against the Mets last weekend, and two of them game winners. One against Paul Wilson on Friday. That set the scene for that road trip after Wilson had pitched a brilliant game. Leading 2-1, two on, two outs. And Sosa with a three-run homer to win it. And then he won it on Friday, on Sunday also. Ordonez hurries. Nice pick by Bronya. One out here in the second. Luis Gonzalez coming up.
Knew he had a hustle there. Sammy Sosa's got some pretty good speed. He can do it. Doesn't take him very long to get rid of it. With Rico over there at first, he'll help you out on anything down low and in the dirt.
Rico Bronya should have ES behind his name. Error saver. Gonzalez off to a good start, and he takes a strike. So Jones has been ahead of four of the five Cub hitters thus far. Outside, one and one. Talking about that chorus of boos with Sammy Sosa, I remember the Pete Rose words about being booed in a gray uniform. He used to say, you know, I love being booed by 13 of the 14 teams in the league.
That's right.
And he was. And Pete properly said he's never been booed in a white uniform, and to my knowledge, I don't, you know, I never heard it.
Why would you?
Yeah, why would you? That's no. Exactly right. Two and two to Gonzalez.
Very few occasions when he was wearing the home white that anyone would be booing Pete Rose. It's kind of a measurement of greatness.
Yep.
How many visiting fan parks are booing you unmercifully?
Still two and two to Gonzalez. And how many players can play as long as Pete Rose played and say that he was never booed at his home park? Almost everybody is booed at one time or another, even the great Stan Musial back in 1960. Ted Williams.
Often.
Yeah. Fly ball, left center field. Johnson backpedaling to make the play in the middle of the warning track. Five in a row now, retired by Bobby Jones.
Number nine, catcher Scott.
See, away from the friendly confines for the Chicago Cubs this season, that road record, 4-10 on the road, where they are 12-8 at Wrigley. One of the reasons they're batting 219 in the games on the road, those 14 games. Tonight, 8 starters, 25 home runs at home, and 9 on the road. It has been a very friendly Wrigley Field for Jim Riggleman's team so far this year.
Scott Service, the catcher, takes a slider for a strike. So 5 of the 6 Cub batters, first pitch strike. One and one to Service. I think you find that with teams, usually a better home record, teams like the Astros playing in the Dome, especially when they were in their early years of the Dome. Dome Belt 1965. The Cubs usually with the better home record. The Boston Red Sox.
Looking
ball
at the
two strikes to Scott Service. Excuse me, Gary.
No, I was looking at the teams this year, just seeing, and Baltimore's had great success, of course, in their yard, and they are again this year. They're 12-8 in double digits. Texas is 14-5 in their relatively new ballpark. I mean, leading the American League West. The teams that are on top are doing very well at home, and that's consistent with the history of this game.
Ground ball toward third. Easy play for Jeff Kinn. A high throw, but Bronya on the bag. So 6 in a row now, retired by Bobby Jones. We'll be back after this from Nobody Beats the Wiz. Boy, is there anybody better than Lawrence Fishburne? What an actor.
No, probably not, huh?
Great. No score, no base runner so far tonight.
Jeff Kent did a little dance for us on that last play. Probably had Rico wondering whether the ball was ever going to get over there. Waited and waited and ran about 6 steps and threw it. I think he had trouble getting it out of this, getting a handle. He got it out of the glove, but watch him trying. He's got the fingers wrapped tightly, and it looks like he's trying to loosen up a little bit to make the throw, and it almost sailed on him.
That's about as close as a third baseman can come to making an unassisted put out at first base.
That's right. 2 more steps, he'd have had him.
1 ball, no strikes to Todd Hundley. And there's that changeup Gary was talking about. 1-1 to Hundley.
Hundley had not hit in the cleanup spot in his career until against Chicago on May 3. He has stayed now in that, in the Chicago series, a couple games in it, and when the team played in Florida, he also batted in that cleanup spot. So that production spot, Dallas Green moving people around a little bit, trying to find some good numbers.
One ball, two strikes to Hundley. Fastball outside, 2-2. It's interesting, that sequence of pitching. A 1-0 changeup, a 1-1 curveball. Hundley, of course, a fastball hitter. He becomes less so after two breaking balls and all-speed pitch strikes. Drill the foul, still 2-2.
You mentioned it before, Timmy, that if he can stay healthy, the kind of season he may have, because right from the get-go, he's hitting the ball like that. I mean, even foul balls, he's tearing it. He's right on the money on it.
He had 8 home runs on April 23rd. He still has 8. Last 3 weeks, he has seen nothing but off-speed pitches. Tapped foul, and there's a perfect example. He got his fastball, and he wasn't ready for it. He hit it the other way. Probably in his mind was that changeup, curveball, and slider.
That's what Castillo can do to you, because he will throw it, as we said, on any pitch. A lot of pitchers would not use a changeup in this situation. Todd knows he might.
He had one in his wheelhouse there. He fouls it back. Now, I was never big on meetings. I always thought that meetings, team meetings between pitchers and catchers, there was a lot of negativity, a lot of things that the pitchers couldn't do. Planting the wrong seed. For instance, going over a guy like Hundley, a young pitcher here, fastball hitter. And then you'd have to qualify it saying, that doesn't mean you can't throw him a fastball. There's the breaking ball, full count to Hundley. It's what surrounds the fastball that gets a hitter out. It's not necessarily the pitch, but how you got there. Certainly John Franco knows that. Still 3-2 to Todd Hundley.
Pretty good battle right here. That 3-2 count on all the foul balls. He didn't get the breaking ball in. Rico on deck.
Slider ripped foul. One thing in situations like this, Todd, very anxious. Tom McCraw wanting him to get a good pitch here. Just under it. A good pitch to hit, and he just missed it. Sammy Sosa in right field makes the catch. One out here in the second.
Pretty good at bat.
Yep.
He fought him, battled off. Had Castillo wondering what he should throw him, in fact. And he got one a little too fat, really. Castillo got away with here, because Todd can go down and get those. You see, he knew right away that he hadn't quite gotten enough of that. He's on it. Keep your head on the pitch.
Rico Bronya now. And look at the Cub infield. Third baseman Leo Gomez playing a shallow shortstop. You don't see that alignment too often.
This is almost a Williams shift here.
It is really odd. Well, if you're Rico Bronya and they're giving it to you, take a little poke down the third base line. Rico's got good power the other way. However, when he hits it to left, he usually puts it in the air. And the curveball gets him. First strikeout for Castillo, two outs in the second.
Somebody, the advanced scout for the Chicago Cubs, who's been watching the Mets, and then the Mets being in Chicago with Riggleman himself seeing them. Something they saw, obviously. There you see the direction of his outfield hits. 10 to right, 10 to left. 6 to center. But as Timmy said, up in the air
right
to left field. So they played it straight up in the outfield and moved the infield way over.
Jeff Kent now. Jeff batting 274. And the curveball is inside, ball one. 1-0 to Kent. The Mets with a scheduled off day yesterday. However, they did play their AAA affiliate, Norfolk, and lost 3-0 with only two hits in that game. 2 and nothing to Kent.
Tim Bogar, though, did get to play every position.
9 positions. Wow. There's a curveball in there. 2-1 to Jeff Kent.
Timmy said before the game today, I said, yeah, fun. He said, I had a great time. It was wonderful. He said, I told Dallas, if he ever needs an out, he can call on me no matter who's up. With a big smile on his face.
This one hit deep to left field. Over is Gonzalez near the line, near the wall to make the play. Castillo takes a deep breath, and we go to Dunkin' Donuts. We'll be right back.
Mitsubishi Mets road trip sweepstakes is Robert Carlson from Glendale, New York. Robert correctly guessed the number of baseballs filling the trunk of the Mitsubishi Eclipse, 599. He wins an all-expense-paid road trip to Atlanta to watch the Mets and Braves on Saturday, September 7th. So, Robert Carlson, congratulations.
599 baseballs in the trunk of a Mitsubishi. Pretty good guess.
Pretty good guess.
Leo Gomez guesses fastball, fouls it back. Nothing and one to Gomez.
Now the next time you're in Jeopardy, you'll know the answer.
Yes.
And the question.
Always good at those questions on Jeopardy.
Yeah, me too.
Breaking ball, 1-1 to Leo Gomez. Both pitchers appear to be very sharp this evening. Only one strikeout, but for the most part, both pitchers staying ahead of the hitters. Jones, as a matter of fact. First pitch strike on 6 of 7 batters. Slider backs up and stays high. Ball 2. 2-1 to Leo Gomez. Bobby Jones going after victory number 3. Gomez is jammed. Johnson coming on to one-handed. Nice play, Lance Johnson. Bobby Jones is a completely different pitcher since he returned from Port St. Lucie in those 2 rehab starts.
Those rehab starts have proven to be very important for him to get the mechanics corrected. And Greg Pavlik said, we told him he just had to get the mechanics down before he was going to be ready to come back and work. And you see a little smile on his face over there because he's doing it. He's got that front foot coming more towards the plate, throwing more dead ahead than across the body, and then better control.
On the first pitch, Ray Sanchez flies to right. 2 outs here in the 3rd inning.
And Timmy, it has to make what we're seeing now. The Chicago batters are going after that first pitch, and it has to be because he's throwing strikes first time around. So now they know that, so they're not going to let it go.
He was around the plate with the first half of the lineup. Now the second half of the lineup is seeing that, so they're going up there hacking. That doesn't mean you have to throw a first pitch fastball
or a strike.
Right. Right, exactly. Once you set the pattern of first pitch strikes, guys are more apt to go out of the strike zone. Castillo takes a strike. Nothing and one to Frank Castillo. Talking about first pitch strikes, there's a guy who could do it. Threw a lot of second and third pitch strikes, too. Fergie Jenkins. Probably as good a control of any pitcher in my era, Ferguson Jenkins. 7-time 20-game winner and a Hall of Famer. Well, he's got to love this game. There have been no base runners through 2.5. We'll be back after this from Miller Brewing. Nary a base runner here at Shea. 15 hitters in a row have gone down. 9 by Bobby Jones, 6 by Frank Castillo. Gary, you mentioned one of my favorite words and a word that's tossed around a lot in baseball, particularly about pitching, and that's mechanics. And my favorite story about that particular word, Glenn Wilson. You remember Glenn Wilson, the zany outfielder of the Phillies and the Pirates, played for Houston.
Houston.
Butch Huskey steps up and the slider's outside. The last 2 years of his career, he owned a service station. And his last spring, he was up, and you rarely hear that word, as Huskey drills one to left field, and this ball is gone. Home run, Butch Huskey, and evidently his mechanics were perfect then.
didn't take long to leave the yard. Second home run of the season, up high. Really the first mistake Castillo has made in location.
Catchers don't catch those high fastballs from those big strong guys as Ray Ordonez takes a breaking ball strike. 1-0 New York. Line drive, right central. So Ordonez with a base hit.
Butch Huskey back in that right field position. Got one up. He is so strong. Lined it. Just over the wall and left field into the bullpen.
So Glenn Davis, his last 2 years with Houston, said in spring training that he was thinking about his mechanics, and the hitting instructor said, "You look pretty good up there." He said, no, I'm not talking about with the bat. I'm talking about my mechanics back at my service station. I'm worried about my mechanics."
All new meaning.
1-0 to Bobby Jones up there to bunt. Outside corner, 1-1. Mark Grace leaving first base too early then. And now he wants to talk to Castillo. Sometimes a first baseman will come in a couple of steps and go back. A good base runner and an adventurous base runner will steal second if he leaves too early. There goes Ordonez. And the bunt was fouled. Rather. Well, I'm telling you, he's young in years only. Usually it takes an experienced base runner to do that, but Ordonez taking off when Grace took off.
Because Grace is charging. He wants to make a play at second. Well, look at this. What a jump. He has second base stolen before the ball ever gets to the plate, but it was bunted foul.
An experienced bunter, and of course Bobby Jones is that, but he's a pitcher. So he's not used to dealing with those particular situations. An experienced guy would take that pitch, knowing Ordonez has the play beaten. And a strikeout. But Bobby Jones doesn't fail too often. He led the National League in sacks last year with 18, but he strikes out here.
Come on, one dog, let's go, bud.
Normally, with that big a jump, a batter would have time to see the base runner going.
Right.
What Timmy referring to, and would know that he's got such a jump. Just take the pitch inside. But Bobby was so concentrating on getting the bunt down, he didn't see it.
Especially a right-handed hitter, because the runner's in front of you. A left-hander, you could understand it. But still, an aggressive play by Ray Ordonez. Lance Johnson, the batter, and the curve is low, ball one.
Had a little trouble with his mechanics on the field at the beginning of the season. Just trying to straighten out his swing. He was great in spring, but the cold weather, he thinks, really slowed the bat down on him. Now he's got it going again, and as you saw, he's hot at the plate.
Yeah, I guess you have to wonder if baseball players and pitchers work on their mechanics. What do guys who fix cars work on if things aren't going right?
Box scores.
Have to come up with a baseball term.
That's
right. Slice foul, 1-1 to Lance Johnson. Still have to be impressed by Ordonez and his savvy. You know, usually it would take an older player who's been around to make a play like that, to have observed a play like that, or to have enough confidence to make a play like that. Line to center, McCray right there, two outs.
I have a sense, Timmy, that as the season goes along here, this situation of Ordonez on and Johnson up will happen a number of times. It creates a great hit and run situation.
Yep.
It also creates some RBI opportunities because Johnson's liable to get up a number of times with Ordonez at second base. And it'll give Lance a chance to bring some people home if Ordonez stays anywhere near the pace he is on at getting on base. That'll help Johnson's average to have somebody like that bopping around first base, bothering the pitcher in the infield.
Ordonez at first base. There are two outs and Jose Vizcaino up, and he takes a fastball strike from Castillo. Nothing and two now to Vizcaino. That home run by Butch Huskey to put the Mets up 1-0, only the second home run in the month of May. They had 28 in April. And both home runs in the month of May have come off Castillo, one by Jeff Kent last Saturday, and tonight by Butch Huskey. Ordonez still looking for his first major league stolen base. Good time to run. 0-2 to Vizcaino. Curveball, did he go too far? Nice play by Service. And no appeal. One ball, two strikes to Jose Vizcaino. Jose entering the game batting .336.
Service has done a very fine job for the Chicago Cubs, both behind the plate and at it here early on this season. There you see that perfect block forming a square with his body in the glove.
There goes Ordonez, sliced down the left field line, and Gonzalez can't get to it. The throw to third, out at third base. Ordonez, who is running on the play, is thrown out by Luis Gonzalez on a spectacular short hop play on the single by Vizcaino. But the Mets take the lead 1-0. We're back after this from Sprite. We'll look at this after the pitch. Gary Thorne in to call it for you.
There's the pitch. Strike one. Look at this.
Well, that is a terrific play by Luis Gonzalez to get Ray Ordonez. It looked like the tag was high and Ordonez beat the play. But you really have to give Bob Davidson, the home plate umpire. I mean, we talk about the umpires and everything. This was great teamwork by two umpires.
Line towards center. Johnson was playing over in the alley and hauls it in. McRae has grounded out and flied out. Bobby Jones going through the order for the second time, one away in the fourth.
Second baseman Ryan Sandberg.
Frank Pulley, the third base umpire, going out for the play. He made a nice play. There's Frank. And then Bob Davidson going down to third. We were talking about it between innings, Gary. That's one of the reasons that, of course, on the horrible death of John McSherry opening day, that's one of the reasons that the National League president, Len Coleman, and American League president, but I forgot his name.
You want Bud Selig in there somewhere?
No, I was going to say Bud Selig, but he's a de facto commissioner.
Foul off down the right.
Never mind, you get my drift. That's why they've been Gene Buttig. So Gene Buttig, I apologize for that. But I was trying to get the point in that they have preached to the umpires to keep their weights down. And certainly if their weights are not down, they can't make a play like this.
Get down to cover the bag.
Yep.
That's what Bob Davidson did to get there. Ryan Sandberg fights off another one. Ryan struggling with an 0-for-9 at the plate right now and an average of 194 for Sandberg.
I just demoted Bud Selig from the de facto commissioner to the American League president.
You may be wrong about that.
Well, I may have the right idea.
That's right. Here's the 1-2 delivery, and he jams him. Fouled off into the Cubs dugout. And it remains at one ball and two strikes. Bud may be wondering just which is the more potentate position.
Yeah.
1-2 delivery. Second base, Vizcaino. And Sandberg is retired. He's 0 for 2 in the ball game. Bobby Jones, no walks or strikeout.
First baseman, Mark.
No base runners on. Two down here in the fourth inning. And Sandberg continues in the 0 for 10 now. Keep you up to date on the scores and other major league games going on, underway full schedule. Giants and our National League scoreboard leading the Pirates. Rockies continuing their road trip after getting swept in Atlanta. One-oh the count. And Mark Grace takes the strike. Grace also has been troubled at the plate. He's now 0-for-8. Still the fifth best average in the league, though. And coming into today's play, Mark Grace fourth in hits in the National League. So he's off to a tremendous start. 351 batting average. Bobby Jones with a 2-1 count on him. And it's 2-2. One of the most fluid of the baseball players in the majors, I think, both at the plate and in the field. It's a real treat to watch. Got that great swing from the left side of the plate and over at first. Very soft hands picking balls up in the dirt. 2-2 count. Mets flame straight away. And Grace lines at the center, and there's the first base runner for the Chicago Cubs. A single by Grace with two down here in the fourth inning. Our Toyota American League scoreboard. Red Sox trying to go on the road with home, and that's win a game. They are struggling mightily at Fenway this year. Orioles also on the road. The Yankees have been red hot. 8 out of their last 10 in the W column for the Yankees. Late starts on the West Coast. Two down here. Sammy Sosa grounded out his first time up. Slider misses away to him. Ball one. Sosa grounded out his first time up in this game, but obviously doing well against the Mets now. He's 5-for-13 with 3 home runs and 6 RBIs against New York. One around. One ball, one strike. Greg Bonet down at first base helping Bob Davidson.
Yeah, that, Gary, there are certain hitters in the National League that in order to get them out, you don't have to throw strikes, and Sosa's one of them. You have to be patient out of the strike zone. 46 strikeouts for Sosa so far this year. That's about 140 at-bats. That's alarming.
That's the dubious honor of most in the league right there.
Right.
1-1 to Sosa, breaking ball again. Jones trying to get him to chase here, and it's 2 balls and 1 strike. Those 46 on top, not only in the league, but also in the majors in strikeouts. Production, of course, comes from the long ball for him as he leads the team in homers and tied with Scott Servais and RBIs for the Cubs with 24. Jammed him that time, 2-2. Powerful hitter, as we saw at Wrigley. They weren't accidents, those shots he put out.
That last one off Jerry DePoto broke a window across Waveland Avenue on the fly.
Right down into it after it left the yard. 2-2 count, runner at first base. And make it 47. Bobby Jones gets his second strikeout, a single for Grace, who is stranded.
Ladies and gentlemen,
the Mets on top, 1-0. Now this word from Nobody Beats the Wiz. Everybody, Gary Thorne, Tim McCarver. As Timmy said, a good house on hand and seeing a very well-pitched game so far. Bernard Gilkey leads it off, lined out his first time up. Frank Castillo gets the ground ball. Gomez over, cuts it off. One pitch and one out here in the fourth.
Catcher Todd Huntley.
Getting all three of their hits in that third inning in the big play, getting Ordonez out at third base to end the inning. Todd Huntley. Todd flied out to right, just missed putting one out in his first at bat. Sixth best slugging number in the National League. Todd owns that. Chop down to first, Grace. Two down.
First baseman Rico
Castillo. Two down in a hurry.
I guess that's what the Cubs could refer to that Primera Base as. First Grace.
The first Grace.
Right.
Rico Brañas struck out swinging his first time up. Two strikeouts for 27-year-old Frank Castillo in the game. Castillo's walked only 10 in the 47 innings that he has worked this year. Trying to pick up a win against the Mets, having lost to them in the series at Wrigley Field. The Mets win out there. He is 1-5 lifetime against New York. Rico's batting at 299. They got the shift on again on him here. Change up, 1-2. The way they played him the first time, third baseman Gomez and the shortstop short hole there. And Sanchez moved around, not behind second base, but way over. 1-2 fastball, misses outside, 2-2.
Usually if your third baseman is that far over, almost halfway between second and third, your shortstop is behind the bag at second.
2-2 delivery, jammed him, fights it off. Cued that one right off the end of the bat, checking to see whether or not he may have splintered it.
You can see the third baseman between second and third, and look at the left fielder playing Rico straight away. That is the indication, as we said earlier, if he goes the other way, it's in the air.
Nobody on here, two down, 2-2, and a full count. Rico can get on. Jeff Kent. Get an at bat here. 3-2. Pull the string on him again. And got him. Three strikeouts. Two of those have been Rico Brogna. The Mets are retired in order. We've completed four now at Shea with the Mets on top. Now this word from U.S. Air. 1-0 Mets on top on the home run by Huskey. Top half of the fifth inning. Cubs will have Gonzalez, Service, and Gomez due up. Bobby Jones, just one hit off him, walked none, struck out two so far. And a line drive base hit. Kent was drawn in, but it wouldn't have mattered. And Gonzalez is on with a leadoff single here in the fifth. Gonzalez on, Service coming up. This break in the action ought to be a great time to break for the great taste of Bud Light. A big hit with fans everywhere because it won't fill you up and never let you down. So make it a Bud Light. Service grounded out his first time up. Mets will play for two here. Hitting 295 at the plate. Scott Service. Little shift here. The Mets, a huge hole between short and third. The way they are lined up against Service. As they've moved Ordonez over towards the bag, squeezing the middle on Service. Fastball strike.
Usually, if you're a middle infielder in a double play situation, you have that invisible rope on your right, and when you go over to cheat for the double play, you automatically pull the third baseman along with you. See how close Ordonez is to second base. Kent should probably be a couple of steps to his left and not that much on the line with Jones working Service away.
Fouled off the fists and off Todd Huntley. Strike two. Todd getting a break from his best friend, the home plate umpire Bob Davidson, who's going to clean the plate off to let Todd regroup.
Todd would do the same thing if Bob were hit.
Absolutely.
Not clean the plate off, but something.
Walk around.
Figuratively speaking.
A two-strike count. Down that right field line. No play. Remains two strikes on service. Service not a speedy runner. Ground ball here. Good chance for the double play. He has already grounded into a team high eight ground ball double plays this year.
That's twice as many as any other Cub.
Gonzalez at first. Nobody out. Jones steps off to get him back to the bag. Both of these pitchers tonight, Jones and Castillo, even up on fly ball ground balls, are not predominantly one or the other in their careers so far. So there's the pitch out. They got him trapped. Gonzalez was going back to first. Rico chases and gets it. The caught stealing.
Credit that to Bobby Wine, who may have picked up anything. That's a danger in running on an 0-2 pitch, because your catcher and pitcher have the luxury of pitching out without really affecting the count. You still have three more shots at him with the count 1-2.
So Gonzalez taken out. One ball, two strike count now on service with one away. And it stays 1-2.
Todd Hundley has now thrown eight of the last 10 runners that have tried to steal. He has nailed them. And if you remember, of the first 24 stolen bases against Hundley, or the first 24 attempts, he threw out only four at one time. His throwing percentage caught stealing was 13%. Now it's 35.
Lance Johnson. And Scott Service is out of there. Two down.
Third baseman Leo Gomez.
Two away, nobody on. With the Mets up 1-0 here in the fifth inning, Leo Gomez, who flied to center. He'll come up against Jones. 0-for-4 against Jones in his career chances against Bobby. Fouls it off. Strike one again. Three hits for the Mets, two for the Cubs. And another ground ball cut off by Jeff Kent. Makes the quick throw right on the money. Gomez is retired. No runs, a base hit, and nobody left on. We go to the bottom of the fifth with the Mets on top. Right after this from your Tri-State Toyota dealer. The long ball and the 21-7 games.
Yeah.
Here's one for you, Tim McCarver. 1-0.
Odd score. The only run coming on Butch Huskey's second home run of the year. And time for our new Dodge quiz. Which Hall of Famer, a native of Puerto Rico, was the only player ever to hit 350 or better in a 100 strikeout season? And we will give our viewers at home a chance to think about it before we take a stab at it. And your phone calls are appreciated.
To whomever you call.
That's right. Call us and with your answers. Jeff Kent takes a slider high, 1-0. Jeff flied to left field his first time up. Two hits for the Cubs, three for the Mets. We're in the bottom of the fifth, 1-0 New York. Leaned out there with a, I guess, a dollar bill. I would think it'd be more worth more than that. He's waving that dollar bill at the ball boy down the left field line. I'm sure number 96 is saying, make it a five and you might have a deal. But for a buck, come on.
Then the other guy was using his kid as bait. See him as, standing there with his youngster? Come on. Look, I got this young fan. Give him the baseball.
Now back, still 1-2 to Jeff Kent.
He's too young to be a full-fledged catcher, so he's only got the hat on the side of his head.
Right.
But it's working it back to the right direction.
That is his Hunts Hall impression right there. Oh, Bowery boys, fastball inside. Hunts Hall and Satch and Pee-wee's Sweets. You remember that, those wonderful movies when we were kids? Leo Gorsi as Chief.
Gardo as himself.
Ground ball toward third. Nice play, Gomez. Nice shift of the feet by Grace. One out. That balletic move that you were mentioning earlier.
Right fielder,
implication of Mark Grace's grace at first.
I just really enjoy the position of first base, watching people play it anyway. But this is one of the reasons why. Footwork over there makes all the difference in the world. It's the other foot he normally would have touching the bag, but he's got to make that play with the off foot, if you will, and with the runner coming at him while he watches the ball.
Butch Huskey from his back foot the last time up, hit his second home run of the year in the fastball from Castillo inside. 1-0 New York, and that's the reason. Slider on the corner, 1-1 to Butch Huskey.
Much still being made about this right field position and what's going to happen to it for the Mets. Carl Everett had it, lost it. Huskey had it, didn't play well. Huskey's back out there again, trying to get the bat going. Carl Everett had a meeting today with Dallas Green and at least one other coach early this afternoon. Came out of it not a very happy person. There have been a lot of stories written that Everett, something wrong with his attitude, that he doesn't look like he's ready to play.
Ground ball toward third, foul, 1-2 now to Huskey.
Oh, I asked Carl about it before the game, and Carl said, look, it's perception. It's Dallas Green's perception that I am lacking something in being ready to go out and play. And clearly what he was saying was, I don't think I am. I think I'm ready to play. And while Butch Huskey is out and right now, Carl said, Dallas told me that position's still open.
Huskey going too far. Complaining with home plate umpire Bob Davidson, but there are two outs here in the fifth.
Shortstop Ray Ordonez.
Take a look. Did he offer at the pitch? Close, but Davidson called that one himself. Didn't ask for any help, felt that he had gone, and that is the home plate umpire's prerogative.
And the fastball to Ray Ordonez. Ray single his first time up. Butch Huskey saying, I didn't think I went too far. Rico Bronya agreeing with him, but nobody's going to disagree with Butch.
No, not over there.
Butch at 240, 6'3 and a half. Anything you say, Butch.
You didn't go around. Not a question in my mind.
Rico probably say, nah, you're right. You're right again. Curveball. Right again, Butch. Ground ball towards second. Sandberg makes the play. And the Mets go in order here in the fifth inning. After five, 1-0 New York. We're back after this from Sunoco. As per usual, after the bottom of the fifth inning, the grounds crew comes out and drags the infield as Ray Sanchez leads it off. But a different ground crew tonight. Fastball on the corner to Ray Sanchez. Ray flied to right his first time up. Tap toward third. Kent diving. Nice play. Throws him out. One out.
Now, the Yankee Stadium grounds crew issued sort of a challenge to the Mets crew. Yankee Stadium's doing the village people stuff.
I love this. We're waxing down our swim. Gotta work on their swim, though. We can't wait for June. We'll all be gone for the summer. We're on safari to pitcher Frank Castillo, the batter. He struck out his first time up, fastball inside.
Then they threw their hats, which are autographed, into the crowd. Souvenir.
That guy doing his impression of Mike Love, lead singer of the Beach Boys.
John Franco signing one of the hats there for the grounds crew members. And as they came off, they flipped them into the seats.
Two balls and a strike. Well, we have to thank our friend Al Troutwig of MSG for thinking up that challenge. Kevin McCarthy is the stadium manager here at Shea. His brother Mike McCarthy is head of MSG, and that's where that challenge came from. Al doing the middle three innings with Jim Cott on MSG. David Cohen, fine announcing crew. 2-2 to Frank Castillo. A little early for the Beach Boys, though. Their motif could have been a little better. Ordonez diving, trying to make the play, but Castillo with an infield hit with one out in the sixth.
Come back. Center fielder Brian McGray.
See where this ball is hit by Castillo, right up the middle. Ordonez on the second base side. Even with the play, if he'd been able to handle it cleanly, not going to get the out at first. Infield single.
Ryan McCray, the center fielder, is 0 for 2. Castillo at first, one out. We're in the sixth. The Mets on top, 1-0, and a fastball strike to McCray. We have given our folks at home a chance for this new Dodge quiz. They could have gone out and bought an encyclopedia, baseball encyclopedia, and found the answer.
I'm still looking for that phone number, though.
Here's our new, finally, our new Dodge quiz answer. Well, it's got to be Roberto Clemente. I mean, you got to think, how many Puerto Rican players have hit over 350 for a season? 1967. Ground ball, Kent, another great play. He gets the lead runner, but two fine plays by Jeff Kent, two outs. Rather.
Steve Stone, the broadcaster, one of the broadcasters for the Cubs, we were talking before the game. He says, you know, I hear about Jeff Kent at third, but every time he plays against the Cubs, he looks like Brooks Robinson. Well, it's happening again. He has made a couple of very fine plays over there. This one not only denies the base hit, but takes out that lead runner. No chance for two.
Brooks Robinson couldn't have made those plays any better than Jeff has made in this inning. McCray, a base-stealing threat at first. Slider for a strike to Sandberg.
That's something, how I was just thinking that has become the comparison. There you see the numbers for Bobby. A very, very effective performance so far. That is a tremendous ratio. Robinson is now the standard at third base.
Or Mike Schmidt.
Or Mike Schmidt. But the World Series, Robinson's World Series.
1970 against Lee May.
Put him in that, maybe that little step above as far as the public's perception and what they think of when they think of the great fielding third baseman, because of that series was absolutely spectacular plays he made.
Line to right field, and Huskey right there. Sandberg hits it right on the button, but two fine plays by Jeff Kent spells the end of the Cubs here in the sixth. It is 1-0 New York. We're back after this from your Tri-State Toyota dealer. 1-0 Mets here in the bottom of the sixth inning as Bobby Jones leads it off. And he has just been terrific. Actually, Castillo has two. Frank has allowed three hits. Jones, three hits. But one of the hits allowed by Castillo, a home run by Butch Huskey with no one aboard in the third. Strike one to Bobby Jones. in there. Nothing and two to Bobby Jones. Well, commenting on what you said in the last half inning, Gary, about the right field position, I think the Mets have two problems that are of major concern right now. Their bullpen, number one, because there are a bunch of people involved, not just one, but the right field position. That's just one position as Jones goes down. Of course, there are others involved. Carl Everett, even Kevin Roberson has been given a chance to play out there.
Lance Johnson.
And one article coming out saying that Edgardo Alfonso has even been considered. Edgardo says, don't even think of me out there. I'm an infielder.
Just says, I'm not interested. I asked him before the game if there was any truth to it, whether or not he'd even been approached by Dallas Green or anybody else, and he said, nobody's talked to me about going to the outfield. He said, I play second, short, and third.
And he plays them all very well.
Very well. Of course, why it would even be considered is his bat is a damn good one, and it's not in the lineup.
Line to right center, Sosa. Makes the play, a diving catch by Sammy Sosa, two outs. Wow.
Seeing a baseball game here tonight, folks. This is the way it's supposed to be played. Sammy Sosa, as we said before, has a pretty decent speed anyway. Nice jump on this ball. Never hesitated in the thought about catching it. And fortunately for him, was able to get that glove to slide without getting that wrist turned the other way. You know, nice play.
I was thinking the same thing. As a matter of fact, back in 1985, we saw Daryl Strawberry ripping that tendon apart and his right thumb making a similar play and getting that glove curled around. Of course, Daryl, a left-handed thrower, and he missed a good portion of that year. Nothing and one to Vizcaino with two outs and none aboard. Good changeup, nothing and two. It's funny how the changeup causes a hitter to swing the bat in a changeup fashion.
Slows you down.
Yeah, slows you down. One and two to Vizcaino.
The Davey Johnson theory of even from game to game, having one pitcher with that great fastball, follow him up with a guy in your rotation who throws more of the junk stuff. And the hitters who have for a day have seen good heat come back the next day with a pitcher who throws the off-speed stuff, it takes him a while, he always felt, to adjust.
Mets had that rotation in 86. You have Ojeda, Gooden the fireballer, Fernandez the fireballer, Darling, more on the line of Ojeda. Well, the Mets go in order, and Sammy Sosa proves once again that he is anything but a so-so outfielder. 1-0 New York after six. We're back after this from your Tri-State Jeep and Eagle dealer. Here's Gary.
And Mark Grace will lead it off against Bobby Jones. Grace, one of the three Cubs hits in the game, a single in the fourth inning. Batting at 356. Bobby Jones gets him to foul that one off. One ball, one strike. Grace finished up last season among the leaders, fifth in batting average. He's a career 306 hitter, upped it last year, batting 326. Is in a groove to raise that career average again this year with the numbers he's putting up. 1-1 count on him. Two balls and one strike with Sosa and Gonzalez due to follow. Grace, a consummate doubles hitter in his career. He always, year after year, pounds out the two baggers. Leads the Cubs this year. He's picked up 10 so far. Good gap hitter.
Led the National League with 51 last year.
2-1 pitch to Grace. And Bobby Jones falls behind. You see Todd Hundley just then settle it back. Three balls and one strike. Jones trying to win his third consecutive game. The last one came against Chicago in that 7-3 win. 6 1/3 he worked in that one. To right field base hit. So on a 3-1 pitch, Mark Grace delivers a single leading off the seventh inning. So he's 2-for-3. All singles off Bobby Jones in this game for the four Cub hits. Leadoff man on for the second time in seven innings for the Cubs. And the ever dangerous Sammy Sosa. We got a smattering of applause for the catch and continuing boos for the home runs at Wrigley.
That catch once again, one out and nobody on in the sixth. Lance Johnson, the batter. And Sosa with a beautiful catch, robbing Johnson of perhaps extra bases.
Lead runner on, Grace being held at first. Sosa chops it. Jeff Kent only plays at first. Got him.
Left fielder.
That's a hard play because we talk about patience a lot in baseball. You have to be patient for a ball like that and prepare your feet to make a quick release with your arm. You make a play like that, a third baseman has to be in throwing position when he makes the play because of Sosa's speed. Nice play by Jeff Kent.
Now a runner at second base as Sosa retired. Close play at first. One down. And Luis Gonzalez takes the breaking ball for a strike. Mets are leading here 1-0. A very strong number. 480. Runners in scoring position. Gonzalez on top in that department for the Cubs this year. 0-1 ripped to second, bobbled, and the runner will hold at third. Vizcaino at least stopped it and for the moment saved the run. A shot right at him.
Catcher Scott Service.
First and third with one out.
Interestingly, you saw Ken, who had to be patient on his ground ball. Vizcaino with nowhere to go. The in-between hop hits the heel of the glove. And an error on Vizcaino, but a tough error at that. That ball ate him up. Ate him up.
He had no chance to position himself to make any kind of play on it. Was either do it on the short hop or not. So the Cubs with their first real scoring opportunity of the game. First and third, Scott Service. One down, Mets will play for two. Line to left field, Gilkey coming in, tagging at third is Grace. Here comes Grace, throw to the plate, comes through. Gilkey makes the play.
Time now to stand.
Grace retired. Mets still lead. Now this from Mitsubishi. It's a great ball game here at Shea tonight. Bernard Gilkey making that play to throw out the potential tying run at the plate. Grace, they got him, and he leads the inning off here. 0 for 2 for Gilkey tonight.
Bernard now leads the National League in assists with 7. He led the Cardinals for the last 3 years, hitting the cutoff man. Two hops to Hundley, and Grace is dead at the plate. Fine play by Bernard Gilkey. What an all-around package the Mets got in Bernard Gilkey. He has just been terrific.
326 average, 7 homers, 29 RBIs for him. Castillo missing to him, 2 balls and 1 strike.
Boy, does Castillo ever remember Bernard Gilkey. He pitched a no-hitter last year against the Cardinals for 8 2/3 innings. Who broke it up? Bernard Gilkey, an opposite field triple.
One out away from that no-hitter, and this is the man who took it away from the guy he now faces on the mound, Frank Castillo. 2 balls, 2 strikes. We have had a season's worth of defensive plays made in this game.
Jeff Kent, 2 at 3rd in the 6th inning. Sammy Sosa in right field. Bernard Gilkey's throw home.
Even the error charge to Jose Vizcaino prevented the run from scoring. He at least got there and knocked it down.
You know, the odd thing about that play, why is Todd Hundley still have his mask on? Really blurs the vision of a throw. You clear it without the mask. I don't understand why Todd kept his mask on.
Grounded towards the hole. Sanchez. He got him. And the D just keeps on coming. One down.
Before we look at that play at short, here's another angle. I'll tell you, it is much more dangerous for a catcher to have his mask on with a runner coming in. Not only dangerous for the runner if he hits him, but dangerous for the catcher. If you are jarred with an elbow or a shoulder or a spike in the mask, it can be very, very dangerous and bad on the helmet.
Ooh. Drive it right back into your,
yeah, absolutely,
into your head.
And here's that fine play by Ray Sanchez. This is a game that even James Longstreet would love.
Yeah.
James Longstreet, one of the famous generals in the Civil War, actually responsible for trench warfare methods in World War I. That's how far ahead of his time he was. Defensive measures. And had Robert E. Lee, old Bobby Lee, listened to him at Gettysburg.
Ooh.
Might have been a...
dug in.
You might have been saying y'all instead of saying what they say up in Maine. Whatever that is.
Yeah. Two ball, one strike count on Hundley. And a high strike you didn't like to and do. All because of trench warfare, huh?
Yep.
Our National League scoreboard.
That was a rather broad conclusion.
It was.
That argument went. All because of defense in this ballgame.
Long street to get there. You see the Braves leading 11-0. Chance for a seven-game winner in that one, Timothy.
John Smoltz could be the first seven-game, could be, will be, the first seven-game winner in the majors as Tunley is called out on strikes.
Not happy about it either, turning to Bob Davidson, and Davidson's got the mask off, almost threw him. Davidson started with the arm, was very close.
See, Todd Hundley didn't take his mask off, but Bob Davidson did. And when they take their mask off, that means they're close to running somebody.
That was protecting his catcher now, picking up the argument.
Dallas probably saying that Todd was walking away, wasn't showing Davidson up. I'm sure that's Dallas's argument. Had what he had to say. Of course, what he had to say may have ignited that little spat.
Rico Brogna has struck out twice. That's seven strikeouts now for Castillo.
Now, it could have been a strike.
Pretty good pitch.
Now, the one thing about arguing with an umpire from an offensive standpoint is that you have to go back out there and you're 2 feet in front of that same umpire.
Davis is going, now I cleaned the home plate off for this guy after he got hit so he could regroup. And look what he does to me.
Now, it's a 1-0 ball game. It's a very difficult situation for Todd Hunt. He's got to forget about that and go back out and handle Bobby Jones.
One ball, two strikes on Rico Brogna. Mets leading at 1-0 on the home run by Huskey in the third inning. Bottom of the seventh, Castillo, center field McRae. These two pitchers continue to get help and continue to do what they need to do as well. We have completed seven. Take a look at our Miller Line score. It is a classic. We'll return right after this message. Welcome back. Bobby Jones, no walks, two strikeouts. Good defensive help, but he has pitched a magnificent game here. Four singles, that's all the Cubs have picked up off him tonight. Leo Gomez leads it off here. He's taking. And a 2-0 count. Tired of the numbers. Mets have stranded only one base runner. Three have been left on by the Cubs. Nobody left in scoring position in this game. Jones just bearing down to get the strike 2-1. Toyota American League scoreboard will take a look at for you here with the Red Sox battling back against the Jays. Foul back. Sox have jumped out on the Yankees at Comiskey. Rangers, another one of the surprise teams in the majors this season. They've got a four-game lead over California in American League Western Division. Two balls, two strikes on Gomez. Bobby Jones, inside 3-2. Didn't know these two teams were battling to get out of losing streaks the way they played tonight here. The Mets trying to get out of that four-game losing streak. Chicago's lost three, and there is the first walk of the game. And a leadoff walk here in the eighth inning.
Shortstop Ray Sanchez.
Just in case. Mets will get the bullpen ready in a one-run ball game. And we'll get a pinch runner. Hernandez comes on to run. Put the speed out there for Gomez.
18, Jose Hernandez.
Gomez went out looking for a walk, and he got it.
Greg Pavlik, the pitching coach, has to be very pleased with the performance of Bobby Jones, but it's only through the first 21 outs.
While they chat, we remind you this copyrighted telecast is authorized under television rights granted by Sterling AA Enterprises LP solely for the entertainment of our audience. Any publication, reproduction, or use of the pictures, descriptions, and accounts of this game without the express written consent of Sterling AA Enterprises is prohibited. Any commercial or other use of the program, such as by charging admission for its showing, is likewise prohibited.
Couldn't help but see that Yankee score and think of our old friend David Cohn, who underwent an operation today at Columbia Presbyterian Hospital. Chicago over the Yankees 3-0. But more importantly, David Cohn appears to be all right. The aneurysm in his right shoulder, a vein taken out of his left leg. This operation successful. And maybe David's watching the broadcast tonight, either this broadcast or the Yankee broadcast. And our sincere get well wishes to a great guy and a great pitcher.
Hopped up. But can't be played. Foul ball. Sanchez trying to move it up. Hundley and Bronya both close, but not quite.
Now, this is odd strategy by Jim Riggleman. Some managers feel, however, that you have to tie it before you have to win it. Other managers feel more strongly that to tie on the road with those extra three outs really, say they tie it in this inning. Well, the Mets have six outs to score to break the tie, and the Cubs have three outs. That's why you don't bunt to tie on the road. But Jim Riggleman thinking differently, but he could change it now and put the hit and run on.
Sanchez, the number eight hitter in the lineup. Castillo, the pitcher, has come out in the on-deck circle. They, however, have the bullpen ready if they want to make a move. Ray Sanchez hitting just 214, 0 for 2 in tonight's game. Squares again. They charge at the corners. He takes it down low. Two balls and one strike. Perez has been warming up in the bullpen. Gave the tip of the cap. He's ready.
Deeper in the count a pitcher goes, the more inclined a manager would put the hit and run on. 2-1. Ideal hit and run count here. He's going to get a fastball.
Hernandez, the pinch runner, drops it down to first. Bronya may have a chance at second. Decides against it and goes to Vizcaino covering. So a sacrifice by Sanchez moves Hernandez down to second base. One away.
So the sacrifice is successful, but the Mets making very sure of one out. Whenever a team bunts to tie, especially in the late innings, you realize that your advantage, and once again, it's a very simple concept. If the Cubs were to tie it here in the eighth inning, the Mets would have six outs to try to break the tie, and the Cubs would have three outs. And that's why, in my opinion, that's a bad play. I think if you're going to make any play in that situation, you pinch hit for Sanchez.
And go for it.
Yeah. And then go to go ahead.
Now Castillo's out of the game as a result. Scott Bullitt will be the pinch hitter with a runner at second base. Bullitt is 3-for-15 as a pinch hitter. The infield is going to play in at the corners and back at second and short. even with a bag at first and third.
That's because Bullitt can fly. You may remember before the Sosa home run, it was Scott Bullitt who pinch bunt successfully to lead off that inning last Friday against Paul Wilson.
Fouls that one right off the plate, and Bobby Jones goes up with a count 0-2. Career pinch hitting numbers. He's been effective off the bench. And for Castillo, a great performance, 7 innings, a run on 3 hits off him. He didn't walk anybody and struck out 7. The big blow off Castillo, that home run by Huskey in the third, which is the only run up there. And now he's got to see if his teammates can tire it or give him a chance to win it with a lead. Bobby Jones, the 0-2 pitch. He got him with heat.
Center fielder Brian McGray.
Bobby going out of the strike zone. Look at Todd Hundley sitting in. And Jones missed by about 1.5 feet. See how Hundley has to reach for the ball? Another indication that pitchers just don't get it where they want it to all the time. Sometimes as hitters, you give them too much credit.
Yeah. Hernandez at second base. The leadoff batter, Brian McRae, coming up. Todd Hundley takes the timeout here. First base open, 2 down. McRae 0 for in this game, but Dallas Green, who loves to let his starters go as long as they can. He believes in keeping the starters out there, and especially with the bullpen, as ineffective as the Mets bullpen has been.
Infielders are reminded with 2 out and a runner on at second base that if you can't field the ball cleanly, try to keep it in the infield. So the middle infielder's playing just a step or two deeper. Problem with that is McRae can fly down the line.
Breaking ball and misses. Ball one. Gray batting at 306, a 3-game hit streak coming into this game, but an 0 for 3. And again, the numbers so prevalent on the Cub hitters. Road averages way below what they've done at Wrigley. Jones checks. 1-0 up high to him. 2 balls and no strikes to McRae. And they're going to put him on. So a couple of pitches to see if he'd chase. He didn't. Ryan Sandberg on deck has been in a big slump. He'll come up with 2 on here and 2 down. Ball 4.
We keep going back to that game last Friday when Dallas Green walked Mark Grace to get to Sammy Sosa. Sammy Sosa promptly hit the first pitch off Paul Wilson.
Second baseman Ryan Sandberg.
And everybody's saying that Dallas made the wrong move. We talked about it last Sunday, in our opinion, or last Saturday, in our opinion. He made the right move, especially with a guy like Sosa, who was 0 for 18 before that at bat. So he's playing a similar situation tonight, putting the potential go-ahead run on base in McRae and pitching to the slumping Sandberg.
So let's see what happens. There you see Ryan Sandberg. The overall average is just 191 for him. He's 0 for 3 in this game and 0 for his last 11. First and second occupied. Jones misses inside to him. Ball one. Sandberg, a couple of hits in 12 at-bats lifetime against Bobby Jones. Mets up 1-0 in the 8th inning. Hernandez the lead runner at second base. Fastball up high, 2-0.
Jones missing up high with his fastball in this inning more than in any other.
Swung on and missed. Nasty slider down and away that he went after. Out of the strike zone probably, but a good pitch.
Well, this is a wicked slider right here, and you're right, it was out of the strike zone.
2-1 count. Hernandez at second, McRae at first. Look back to second. No coverage, just gets him back. Got good speed now in both of these base runners who are on, bear in mind. Hernandez and McRae can motor. 2-1. Popped him up. Shallow left. Gilkey. And the inning's over. Good job by Bobby Jones. Battling back. Two are left on by the Cubs. Mets lead it. Now this from Sprite.
Mike Perez, 1-0 on the year. He is in relief of Frank Castillo, and Castillo pitching brilliantly tonight, but he's been bested thus far by Bobby Jones. Jose Hernandez comes in the game, remains in the game, at third base for Leo Gomez.
See the congratulations to Bobby Jones working his way through that last inning. Battling his way through. Dallas Green loves to see that in his pitchers.
Who would ever thought, Gary, that Ryan McCray would be walked in front of Ryan Sandberg?
Fly ball deep left field by Jeff Kent at the warning track. The catch made by Gonzalez. Kent retired.
Right fielder Butch Huskey.
Times they do change, don't they?
Yep, they do.
Ryan Sandberg just having a horrendous time getting on track offensively.
Jeff Kent hit it down just a little bit too much on the end of the bat, and Gonzalez makes the play. Kent has just missed two long balls tonight.
Man who didn't miss it, Huskey, delivers another base hit. Butch had the home run in the third inning and delivers a one-out single here in the eighth. Well, the Mets would love to add to this 1-0 lead. Each team now has four hits. Ray Ordonez coming up here with one away and one on. Day in, day out at Homer on the Road, you can always count on the great taste of Bud Light. It won't fill you up and never let you down. So make it a Bud Light.
Running for Butch Huskey, number 5, Chris Jones.
Huskey the applause as he leaves the game, and Chris Jones will run for him. And we'll get a timeout as Ferguson Jenkins comes out of the Cubs dugout.
See, here's the situation again. We talked about it earlier in the year that you are pinch running your best hitter against left-handed pitching off the bench, and that's Chris Jones. The Cubs, not coincidentally, have a left-hander warming up. To me, if you're going to pinch run somebody in this situation, you'd pinch run a guy like Carl Everett, who's a better defensive right fielder, and save Jones for your right-handed pinch hitter in case Riggleman brings in the left-hander. I think you waste Chris Jones in this situation, and Carl Everett will be the pinch hitter, and I don't think Carl's is an effective pitch hitter against a left-handed pitcher and Chris Jones. So I think Dallas has done this just the reverse of the way it should have been done, in my judgment.
And of course, Chris Jones has had the great pinch hitting numbers. I mean, for the Mets, spectacular numbers here over the last couple of years. All right, one down. Ray Ordonez up. Runner at first is running. Hit and runs on. Grounded. Stopped over there by Hernandez. Can he get him? Grace. Outstanding pick. Hernandez knocks it down, and Mark Grace picks it out of the dirt with Ordonez going in head first.
It is a brilliant play once again by Hernandez and Grace. But I guess the key thing here is Ray Ordonez diving into first base. Boy, you just hate to see that. Chance of him getting hurt are great, and sure enough, here comes Riggleman for the left-hander.
Your premier shortstop, your future in the field, with his hands going into the bag.
That's the most important thing, but I think Carl Everett's going to be hitting right-handed. And again, we've got to say it, you know, Carl Everett, my judgment, in my opinion, he's got to be the pinch runner. And now you've got Chris Jones to pinch hit against the left-hander.
Bob Patterson, the left-hander, is on his way in. This call of the bullpen brought to you by 9X. And we'll be right back after these messages.
Mike Perez is out of there. Runner on at second. The Mets up by one. What a great ball game this has been. Bob Patterson, 1-1. on the year, formerly with the Pittsburgh Pirates. Jim Leland loved this guy, and he has really found a home in middle relief for Chicago.
Patterson's last outing 3 days ago against Montreal. Then he worked an inning and struck out one. He will come on here to face Carl Everett, who's been announced as the pinch hitter as Riggleman makes the move. Try and get the matchup he wants here to keep this a one-run ballgame.
I'll tell you, we'll allow you folks at home a chance to cringe again as Ray Ordonez goes in diving in the bag, a man who makes his living with those marvelous hands of his, where you just hate to see him diving into first base like that.
May require another face-to-face with Dallas, as he had to do with Jeff Kent.
Yep.
Finally got Jeff to slide in feet first. Carl Everett, two down. Fouls it back off the left-hander Patterson. Carl Everett, the switch hitter. Batting right-handed, only three at-bats. One for three left-handed. Those are his overall numbers. Big potential run with Jones out there. The pinch runner at second for Huskey, who had the one-out single. Two down. The breaking ball misses down low. One ball and one strike to Everett. Infield straight away on him. So is the outfield on Everett. Jones, pretty good lead at second base. 1-1. Huge foul outside of first. One and two.
You might say, well, you've got left-hander Lance Johnson on deck. Why not walk Everett? Obviously, Jim Riggleman's done his homework. Last year, Carl Everett batted .210 against left-handed pitching, .286 against right-handers.
Career pinch hit numbers for Everett. One ball, two strikes. There's Johnson waiting on deck. There are two down. Patterson outside with it, 2-2. Perez, two-thirds of an inning, gave up one hit. John Franco ready to come on. A save situation in all likelihood in the ninth. 2-2 by Patterson. Swung on and missed. No, foul tipped. Got enough to stay alive. Off-speed breaking ball.
The governor called. The last minute.
Just issued that pardon in time.
Had Scott Servais, by the way, had that ball bounced off his chest protector and into his glove, it still would have been new life for Carl Everett. A catcher cannot have the ball bounce off the protector and then catch it with the mitt. If, however, it hits the mitt and then something else, and then he makes the play, then he can make the foul tip catch, but it hits his chest protector first, and of course he doesn't make the catch.
Evens the count at 2-2. And it's full. Three balls, two strikes, two down. Mets leading it 1-0, trying to add to it here. Jones off second base. 3-2 pitch, swung on line towards the gap. Everett comes through. A base hit all the way to the wall. Jones will score. Everett a stand-up double, 2-0 Mets.
Maybe that meeting with Dallas Green did something with Carl Everett. The 2-2 pitch was fouled back. He got life and took advantage of it, hitting one into right center. And I made the comment earlier that Chris Jones should have been the hitter then, and Everett should have been at second, and I stand by that. However, it turned out very well for the Mets. Carl Everett coming through with a double to right center field.
Everett gets his third RBI of the year. Now they'll go to third. Did he touch? Yes, says Frank Pulley. Questioning whether Jones touched third, rounding it as he scored. five hits now for the Mets. Two down and Lance Johnson 0 for 3 in the ball game, batting 302. Makes the pitch down low from Patterson.
Think of the two hits that drove in runs tonight, both by right fielders of the Mets. One by Butch Huskey, the other by Carl Everett.
That problem position.
Yeah.
Strike on the inside corner.
But sometimes I'll tell you, Gary, that can really pick a ball club up. Not only that they win the game, but that the right guys get the hits that allow them to win the game.
Everett towards the gap in right center. Sammy Sosa moves over and makes the play. But a big run picked up on a couple of hits here in the eighth inning. Carl Everett with a pinch hit RBI. We go to the ninth with the Mets leading 2-0 after this from Bud Light.
Top, a key run in the eighth inning, a double by Carl Everett, driving in Chris Jones. Here in the background, Johnny Be Good by Chuck Berry, and that's what Dallas Green hopes tonight. Hopes his Johnny is good. 2-1 on the year. He has five saves, 300 saves for his career for John, and nobody in this ballpark hoping for another save, 301, than Bobby Jones, who just was superb tonight.
The Jones will wait and watch. Chris Jones will stay in right field, taking Huskey's place for the Mets. Bobby Jones working the solid eight innings. You take a look at our Nobody Beats the Wiz game summary. Castillo, seven innings, fine performance himself, but he could be the loser. Jones, the four hits, eight innings, no runs, only two walks, one of those intentional. Huskey, the solo homer in the third. That's 4-1 in their last five here at Shea, and a chance to win this one three outs away. But the middle of the order is coming up. Grace, Sosa, and Gonzalez. John Franco is going to be honored here tomorrow prior to the game. Trophy will be presented to him by the Mets for reaching that save mark of 300. And also a donation going to his society for Seaman's children on Staten Island. $3,000 donation being made, in fact, tomorrow. Franco would love to go into that ceremony with another save. 301 right here. Grace takes the strike. One ball, one strike.
It is a huge difference going into the eighth and ninth innings with a two-run lead as opposed to a one-run lead.
Grace takes the pitch, just missed. Franco thought he had that one, 2-1.
The biggest difference is the infield alignment. You move your third baseman off the line, your first baseman off the line.
Two ball, one strike count. Even up at 2-2. Trying for a combined shutout here at this point. Cubs have been shut out one time this season. Two balls and two strikes, career numbers for Mark Grace versus Franco. Ninth inning, 2-0. That's on top. 2-2, and that'll go foul. Grace, the 2-for-3, two singles tonight, got thrown out in a big play at the plate in the seventh inning by Gilkey, trying to score and tag on a fly ball. Two and two.
And he got it.
Franco, the off speed. One down.
That is a pitch that John Franco doesn't throw often to left-handed batters. But that's his best pitch to right-handers. That's the dead fish down and in. The reason he doesn't throw it a lot to left-handers is that's a very volatile area. But boy, that ball really, bottom really fell out of that one.
Grace retired. One down. Sammy Sosa's an 0 for 3. At least this time, even if he hits another home run, it won't win the ball game.
Yeah, right. Or tie it.
Or tie it. The 0-1. Right field. Jones. Two down. Fifty-one appearances he's made. 17 saves against the Cubs over the years.
Pitch hitting for Luis Gonzalez, number 30, Ozzie Timmons.
Ozzie Timmons now will pinch hit as Jones waits to see if he can get his third win in a row and third of the year. Timmons will pinch hit with two down here in the ninth. Franco gets it in for a strike. Timmons 1-for-9 as a pinch hitter, has had only 26 total at-bats this year.
That's another luxury that one extra run gives you in the ninth inning. You can throw the fastball down the middle of the plate to get ahead, knowing it's taking.
Trying to get a base runner on. One ball, one strike. Franco, the 1-1 delivery. Timmons fouls it back, and it's one ball, two strikes. Fans rising. The 1-2 delivery. Two-two count, two away. No play. John Franco now in a chase. One to get out of the tie. He's in with Bruce Sutter, that 300 save mark for seventh on the all-time list. Chance to do it here. Jones watching that last pitch. Again, the 2-2. Towards short. Ordonez for the final out of the game. Mets win it. Jones gets his third win. Franco is 301st career save and a shutout as the Mets have beaten the Cubs 2-0 in a heck of a baseball game.
Boy, I'll say. Woo.
Jim Riggleman's Cubs have now lost four in a row and the Mets get out of their four-game losing streak. Dallas Green can smile a little bit. Mets 2, Cubs 0. We'll be back after this from Mitsubishi.